All right, we're going to start probably about 10 minutes after. So if you need to do anything, we're going to start a few minutes after too, so that it will give Ben to make sure he'd be able to log in. So those of you who are here waiting. Let's pause that.
It's a pleasure to be here with all of you guys. I mean, virtually, right? I'm in my own room, but this is an interesting one because I can't actually see anybody's faces except Oscar's.
Do me a favor, everybody, turn on your screens so that you can have somebody to talk to so we can see some reactions. It's really hard for us sometimes when we just see these names, you know? Uh-huh. So just be nice to us just for this one time. You don't have to do it for me in my class, but please do it for our guest.
And you don't have to keep it on either. Do you know what I'm saying? Just I wanted to make sure Arthur wasn't playing a trick on me. making me do like a fake Zoom. He wasn't like pranking me. He's like, yeah, sure, come talk to these people.
Got it.
Anyway, like I said, that's good. You can turn them off.
I think he muted himself.
There you go. You're not. You should be unmuted now.
Oh, I was muted?
Now you're not.
Okay. Sorry. Benjamin Timpson. That's me. Assistant professor of photography at ASU. Arthur's right. I did go to Indiana University. I studied under James Nakagawa and Jeffrey Wolin.
Yes.
Yeah. And James is still there. James is excellent professor. And Jeffrey retired the year that I went there, and we went to Paris right before. So highly suggest that program it's a good school. I can't say enough good things about it. Jerry Yulesman went to school there too, if any throw back to early photographers. All right. So how many of you saw the Skidmore talk or the videos online? I'm just trying to gauge like what you guys want me to talk about. So there's one, two. Okay, cool. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. We have about 30 minutes. I'm going to go pretty fast through some like previous old work, show you the three current main projects. And then since we're in the studio, I'm in my studio right now. You guys are lucky. I brought my camera from my office today, this morning. I brought it back to my studio and set it up because I have to do some repairs on it. You guys will see that. But I wanted to show it to you in person. I wanted to like just give you guys an active, like basically what I'm doing every day, right? It's making artwork. And that's what, like, if you have the passion and you want to like be a professional artist, like you're going to be making artwork, you're going to be teaching, you're going to be talking to galleries. Like it's a job. It's a full-time job. But let's show you guys this, and I can show you. And after I show, you guys all see that? Okay, so I always start with this quote here, Marshall McLuhan. This is a photograph by Yusuf Karsh. Yusuf Karsh is an excellent studio lighting photographer. If you're into studio lighting and lighting the portrait, look up Yusuf. He's an excellent, excellent photographer. Really good with people too. Okay, so he says the medium is the message, right? And I know that's a pretty weighted sentence and people throw it around. They don't really know what they're talking about. But what he meant by the medium is the message is the medium itself, not the content that it carries, should be the focus of study. So that means don't just study light in a room, study the light bulb and how the light bulb changed our way of thinking from we couldn't even work at night because we didn't have any light, but now we can never stop working because we have that medium. Okay. He also talked about how cubism does the same thing. You don't just look at, and remember, this is 120 years ago that cubism was, right? It's been a long time since then. But when you actually have to stop and look at the whole of the composition before you're just sucked into the perspective of that Renaissance perspective or the way the photograph records that object, okay? Thinking of the whole and why the whole is there in culture is very important to think about as an artist, okay? I came from two very different backgrounds. My dad was Swedish and English with a belief in science, philosophy, and free thinking, right? And my mother is Native American and Hispanic with a very strong connection to nature. She's like a master gardener. And then this is me on the left here. This is my first art exhibition. I was 7. These are my 3 oil paintings I did. Anyway, I've loved art since I was a child. I've been doing it for a long time. And like Arthur said, I've lived in a lot of different places. Just to decode that for you guys, born in Salt Lake City, never lived there. Then it went Idaho, Wyoming, Michigan, Nevada, Missouri, South Carolina, Indiana, Colorado, Fort Collins. I was adjuncting Anderson Ranch. Write that down. It's a residency program. It's a art, like, it's a nonprofit art center. It's a really cool place. Just get on their radar, like, and know who they're bringing in, because they're bringing in top contemporary artists all the time. And you can end up taking workshops or getting possibly a scholarship through your school that then you could go to, like, Aspen, Colorado for a week and learn from, you know, top artists. So great there. And then now I'm in Arizona in Phoenix. I didn't put that one on there, right? This is a shot of Lovelock, Nevada, where I kind of figured out where art and culture were through music mostly and how artists express themselves, right? My favorite photograph is this one here when we pointed the Hubble telescope into the absolute blackest part of the sky we could find, and we found hundreds of galaxies. So the potential and possibility of pointing your lens into the absolute unknown and believing in that and then getting something is basically, for me, what art is all about, right? Like, just believing in what you're doing and not giving up. So real quickly, film in the year 2000 was still pretty dominant, and the Fuji Fine Pix on the right here, I actually had that camera to shoot my editing. But that was happening at that time in the 2000s. So I started using the idea of the Marshall McLuhan quote and then film itself to actually create images that were 1 inch by 1.5 inches wide that were my finished works of art. And I know that sounds crazy, but that's what I started doing. And I would use the film and the negative to create color positive portraits. And so what I would do was, for this one, this is the first time I ever did this, I took blue plastic, put it into the color darkroom, I taped it onto my negative of the clouds. Well, first I burned the half the negative, then I put the blue plastic on the bottom of that negative, taped it all together, took it into the color darkroom, and then printed a positive of that. So I was using the negative color spectrum of the blue to create an orange positive for the final print. I was doing that all analog, okay? So I was thinking in reverse and then printing in positive for a whole series there. And then for this one, these ones here, I did a lot of drawings, and so then I would transfer my drawings into organic material on glass slides and then illuminate them. And that's basically what we have here. We're still about 1 inch by 1.5 inches. Very small, meticulous compositions on plastic and glass. And then for this one, I made a little bit bigger. This is the owl. That's a fish head and a rose petal, feathers, soy sauce, worm, and cellophane. And after I got done with these, I called them my negatives or slides. I called them slides at the time. I would photograph them with my digital camera and scan, and then I would combine that all together into a really high resolution photograph that I would then print 4 feet by 6 feet for the galleries. So it was a shift in scale. People would come up to them and like be like, whoa, look at the detail of this. So that was this year. This is 2004 to 2008 for this series. This is the piano, silver maple orchid. The messenger, blood, roots, plastic, and tissue. Sun and moon, moth, ink, sunflower, and plastic. Soldier, blood, cellophane, home soon ribbon. My mother has type 1 diabetes, and she has one of those little pokers. And my brother and I, when we were little, we used to just chase each other around with it. And when we would get each other in the back of the head, and it would make my mom laugh, you know, she still gets a kick out of it. But anyway, so it's just a tiny little prick of blood on a glass slide and then dried. Hanging it up, it's a Christmas cactus, wax and grass. Birth, that's the first time I ever used worm as the symbol for the human. So that's a worm skin wrapped in plastic. So another symbol. Okay, so for this one, this is the love slide. And I really like this one because it's made out of a dove wishbone and blood. And blood is, right? Blood is the symbol for love, and so is the dove wishbone, using the title and the medium in a poetic loop with the composition itself, okay? Thinking about all those things all at the same time. What does the medium mean? How can I represent what the medium means on the simplest level? We're not gonna go too much into this series, but this is the Act Natural series when, I built the LED light panels. See, because before this, you guys, people would be like, oh, these are great Photoshops. You know, everybody thought I did them digitally because I never showed the original. And so I was like, you know, I need to figure out a way to show the originals of these. So I built a fake wall, mounted the light panels behind the wall, put the organic material, the compositions on those light panels, built the wall around that, cut holes in the wall, put light in, and then had the viewer only be able to access it from those like portholes basically. And then at the same time, I still did what I usually do, which is on the right there, make the big, large scale prints. And for those, you can actually see how big they are. They're like 4 foot by 6 foot for some of these prints. They're gigantic. All right, so here's that series. This series was all about the duality, our nature inside of our internal decision-making processes. And how it comes from a Native American quote, there's two wolves inside of us, a good wolf and a bad wolf. And the one we feed is the one that takes our soul, right? So if you continually to do like bad decisions, bad choices, don't be surprised when bad things happen, right? Like bad things happen to everybody. The universe is completely unstable and not fair, right? And we have this idea that it is, but I wanted to really talk about internal decision-making and then the external. Oh, this is a close-up and the detail of one of those. You can actually see the cavities in the lizard's teeth on this one, which is kind of cool. Like that's what it is, you know, like a detail, right? So I won't get too deep into this series, but if you want to talk later about that, like we can. This is the snake eating the mouse on this one here. But then here's what, so the originals are only about 4 inches by 6 inches. But that's what it looked like when someone comes up to that. So you change nature. This is about our stable growth as a species, all while our resources stay finite, right? As we explode as a species, how does the individual deal with this? And so, the first one is at your feet. This was when the bee population was in serious decline, so I used bees and wasps around the feet of the figure made out of wheat. The hair is made out of feather, surrounded by plastic. And here's a close-up photograph of what the resolution is. They're, again, like 4 foot by 6 foot prints. And this is mother and child. The gardener, you reap what you sow. I was thinking about emissions and if we could visually see how much we're putting off through gasoline. And then this is what they look like in real life. So a lot of people are like, what is this? You know, how do you know? And so, you know what we're gonna do? Keep this interactive because I like to keep things moving, but I'll show you guys one in real life. So this is, I'm in the studio, right? So this is what one of them looks like in real life. Okay, so That's the glass in the frame there. And then I have Arduino microcontrollers that are in the back panel of this. Those, I built all this. And then the whole thing is powered up. And my brother helped me. So what happens is they slowly fade on for about 10 minutes, and then they slowly fade off for another. And I can code in, however, the fade, the amount, and then the time and the distance. So it was during this series when I was like, oh, you know what? Right back to that McLuhan quote, what's the most important thing that's going on here? The light. The light is very important in this entire process. In fact, it's deep for 20 years, and I realized that in the last 6 years. It was like, okay, this is what you really need to focus on is that aspect of it. We're back, right? You can see the slideshow. Cool. So here are some more strong gusts of wind, as if like a plastic bag fell on, like ran across this woman's face. And the one on the left is like, oh, don't get near. And the other one's like, I'm really concerned. This one's about, you know, how, you know, these are all in this series of environmental awareness, things melting. And then this one here is like the most current one. I'm still working on this series here, so. We're not going to go too much into obscura, but this is the when I used the worm as the symbol for the human again and dove into like technology, what it would feel like to be growing up online, visualizing that. Alone crowd, you know, I made this in 2015 and now it feels like this is what I'm doing like every day, right? I'm one thing, but I'm also another thing on screen and how people project their identities through social media. This is my favorite one of that series, the landscape photographer. Again, using the negative and the positive at the same time for the finished composition led me into this series here. And these are the two that I wanted to just talk to you about today, which was about face, which this is Oscar, it's a 16 by 20 view camera. And here's the back of it, but I'm gonna show you guys, we're in the studio and I have the camera, so I'm gonna show you that. But so I built the camera. Actually, you know what? Let's do that right now. You guys can all see this. I'm going to move this to the side. I've got about 10 more minutes, right? 10 more 15 minutes.
Yeah, you're good.
All right. So here we go there. Okay. We're basically doing a studio tour now. This is the back of the camera. So now you can see how big and scale it is. I broke the glass, okay? So this is the ground glass. I broke it on the last shoot, so I gotta replace that. But if you ever wanna make your camera, it's really not that hard, okay? So the first thing you do, you need two things. You need a lens and a film plane. Okay, so the first thing you gotta have is a lens. And check this lens out. That's a Carl Zeiss Jena lens, 600 millimeter from the 50s, okay? It's a beautiful lens. Its f-stop range is from 9 to 90. Look at that. Woo-hoo! That's a beautiful lens, okay? So the first thing you got to do is research your lens and your aperture and your diameter, and then you got to figure out what I did with this one. I just taped it to my window, closed all the windows off, and then took a blank piece of paper and found my focal length from that, okay? And then I CNC'd this back part here, the circle right there. I CNC'd that into the wood, mounted the lens, built this, stained it. I was gonna put on better sides, but yeah, they work, right? So that's the front, that's the film. That's the lens. That's step one. You got to have the lens. And then the second one is the film plane and your focus device. And so the whole back of the, this is the whole back of the camera. That's all it is. It's basically a frame and a handle. And this comes out like that, right? So there's your ground glass. And how do you make ground glass? You just take a regular piece of glass and then you take carborundum like 400 grit, and you take another piece of glass and you put that on and you just grind it, the glass on the glass with the carburetor, and you do that for like 6 hours. You take breaks, you know what I'm saying? You get lunch, you get on your phone. Anyway, it takes a while. But once that's done, then I in the metal shop, I welded these handles, okay? And I put them like this. I don't know if you can see that. Okay, so that's the ground glass. Then, let me set this down so I don't break it again. This is your giant negative carrier. So once you get your focus right, so once you focus it, I focus just manually like this. I get my focus right with the ground glass because remember, the subject, the lights are gonna go into the lens, through the bellows, and then upside down and backwards onto that ground glass. So you can see the image. It's a beautiful phenomenon. That's just what happens when light goes through a lens. We didn't invent that. A human wasn't like, gee, I'm gonna figure that out. No, it's been in our eyes. It's how our eyes decode light, right? It's how we know how to stand up on the planet. Okay, so then once you get it focused, then you pull that ground glass out and you replace it with this, which is the negative carrier. And this has to be a light sensitive carrier. And so this is I plasma cut this in the metal shop, and that goes on a slide, and then your paper goes in here. I shoot with paper negatives. Hold on, this is a two-handed gig. Actually, let's just keep that pulled out. So that's the negative slide there. And then this whole time, the person's holding still. You're like, okay, don't move. I'm just gonna go ahead and load up this paper. And so you load up your, I loaded up my paper here, my negatives, and then I tape it into the back of this, put the metal back down, slide this in here like that. This is right here on the back of the camera, right? And these are the bellows right here. So those go like connected like that. And his name's Oscar because I kept the trash bag. You know, he's born in a trash can, Oscar the Grouch. I was going to make like really nice bellows, like laser cut them, but I was like, I want to see if I can get this camera to work, right? And it didn't work for like 2 weeks. I failed. Like, it was ridiculous. I almost gave up. I was like, well, that was a colossal waste of time. But then, you know, you realize that failure is success in geological time. Right? Just by trying, you got to be getting closer to something. Okay? At least you're trying. And so after about 3 weeks of just getting blank paper, I'm going to share my screen here again so we can go back to this. Okay. So there's all Oscar pretty in the studio, right? So I just got these blank exposures, but I finally got it to work, and it worked really, really good. Like, I was like, oh my gosh, this thing's like, it's really working great. And so I realized you have to have a headstand to keep your model still. And those are all 2000 watt pro photo lights. So 6,000 watts of light flashed about 10 inches from the model's face. So you can feel the light and heat when I put the flash off. It's amazing. And then the resolution on these is ridiculous. It's like a comparable to like an 800 megapixel sensor or 16:4x5 negatives. They're 1/16x20-inch negative. But why did I do all that, right? Why did I just tell you guys, you know, like I just built an antiquated camera using paper negatives so I could use someone's cell phone to decode portraiture through your own device. Okay. So right now, rather than looking at a photograph on the wall, static, looking becomes an active experience through your own device because I wake up with my device. I eat breakfast with my device. I go to work with my device. I eat lunch with my device. I eat dinner with my device. I go to bed with my device. Okay. I never leave it. And I wanted to show the topography of strangers' faces without regard to ethnicity or race through someone's own device. Okay. And so this is what it looked like in the gallery. And it would have in your gallery, you know, but we'll just do a virtual. I show them in a grid like this. And you'll see right there, you can start to see. The scale of it. Resolution is ridiculous on some of these, right? We won't go too much into that, but so that is that series, okay? You see, the negative print becomes a vehicle that unifies the assemblage of faces without regard, like I said, to ethnicity or race. The viewer no longer recognizes the face instantly and judges, but first has to decode the image on a very primal level through their own device. Because we live in a time where I can't just stare at somebody's face on the subway or a stranger's face without being called the creep or, you know, like, well, you just can't do that, right? You know, people will hit you or run away or call the police. But I wanted this series to show how beautiful the human face is. Very close up, everyone's face. And so if you have a smartphone, you can do this really quickly. You go into accessibility. I don't know where my phone is. I kind of lost it. Oh, here we go. So you guys want to know how to do this. This is also a really good thing to think about. Like if you're looking at a composition as a photographer, like out in the world, put it in negative on your smartphone and you'll be like, oh wow, that's not a very good composition at all. Like I've got way too much space over here. Like start thinking in the negative and the positive at the same time. So it's access settings, accessibility. On the very bottom, if you're on an iPhone, accessibility shortcut, and then right there, classic invert colors. Color filters, and then you go back to your home screen and you do a triple click, 1, 2, 3, and it'll ask you, classic invert, yeah. And then 1, 2, 3, see that? And then you do color filters, and your whole phone goes black and white negative. So then I go to my camera, and see that? So now I'm negative, right? So that's the trick you use. And if you wanted to do that and try that right now on the portrait, you can. But if not, know that that's a great trick. Oh, it looks like someone's doing it. Nice. Someone did it. That's great. That's cool. Two people did it. That's excellent. See what I'm saying? It's almost like you have to experience it through your own device to be like, oh, wow, I totally, like, no matter how many times I explain this, it's so much better when someone actually just does it. And so I've shot about 500 people now with this project. It's great. And like, I want to scale it up depending on the gallery or the space that it's in. But it's a really fun project. I really, really enjoy this project. Here's that one. And that's a detailed shot of like a 4x5. And so now you know that trick, okay? And so use that trick in your, you can look at your negatives that way if you're in a black and white dark room. We won't go too much into the daily head transplant. Just know that this is a sculpture series about multiple truths in the media, using screenshots as slices on the sculpture itself to talk about contradicting the way we present media in the country. So like if you just watch Fox News all the time, you would think one way. And if you just listen to NPR one time, you would think another way, right? And so I wanted to have a dialogue between those sculptures. And then I turned the whole thing into a print edition here. It's kind of cool. But all right, Metamorphosis. This one, did you guys see the video on the side, or do you guys want me to play it? Everyone
watched it, some didn't. So it's up to you, can show it.
Okay, we'll watch it.
When Benjamin Timpson became profoundly moved by Native American rape survivor Caroline Felicity Antone. Benjamin was shocked by the statistics of violence among Native American women, who are 2.5 times more likely to be sexually assaulted than any other woman in the United States. About the same time, a DNA test confirmed that Benjamin is part Native American. With that revelation, he knew that he had to tell the stories of these largely forgotten women through his work. The deliberate choice of the butterfly wing as the medium of expression for the series was a definitive moment in the conception of the story he would tell. The butterfly is representative of metamorphosis, fragility, beauty, joy, and hope. Conceptually, the butterfly is used as a catalyst. Benjamin's hope is that this series will bring awareness to a very important issue through beauty and change. His use of the butterfly wings has helped shape the conversation around his portraits as symbols of healing. The innate spirituality of that symbol made it possible to turn violence, disenfranchisement, loss, and despair into something beautiful and powerful. The process starts with a photograph of the murdered, missing, or domestically abused women provided to him by her or her family. The finished portrait is composed of hundreds of safe source butterfly wings affixed to glass. Benjamin's work is not just meant to shed light on this largely underpublicized issue of Native American women, but also as a tribute that honors and recognizes the victims.
Okay, so you guys saw there, basically that's like a recap of, you know, the project, the current project right now. So About Face, You Change Nature, and Metamorphosis. Those are the three projects that I'm currently working on right now. And we're in the studio, so I can actually show you guys. Everybody always asks me this question, where do you get your butterflies from? Two places, two sanctuaries, one in North Carolina and one in Australia. And like they come, there's the blue morphos. That's one type of blue morpho. and then here's another type of blue morpho, and you can see a subtle difference. And then when light goes through them, that's how I decide like which one to use. So I'm working with reflected light and transmitted light at the same time, okay? And then conceptually, right, reading articles about the devastating statistics of murdered or missing Native American women in this country really motivated me to create a series about social change and activism through beauty, right? And you guys just saw that I've been working on a light table, exploring the medium and the message for 20 years now. So, you know, it was like, oh, I know exactly what to do with the wings that I've been collecting. And in tribes in the American Southwest, the butterfly is revered and respected. In fact, listen to this, you guys. Every single culture for the past 20,000 years around the entire planet has a deep psychological connection to the butterfly and the enigma surrounding it. It's in pictographs. It's been recorded through time and history. It's always been this like a unicorn or a magical symbol, right? And so it's an incredibly loaded medium. So I wanted to really focus on do it justice, basically. Find the right project for it, for the butterfly and for the women, right? The first portrait I created was Banff Jane Doe. Her remains were found in 1979 and could be a victim of the Highway of Tears. And then this was the finished 4 inches by 6 inches butterflies on glass. Same with all the other series. I take 20 to 30 very close-up photos and stitch the file together. This way the work acts as a large-scale photograph and a precious original object. Here's one of the close up 100 millimeter shots there. I also chose the square there to subtly reference the pixels in today's digital photographs. The second portrait was Pima County Jane Doe. Her body was found 10 miles southeast of Tucson, Arizona. And I wanted this portrait to be familiar yet abstract, and it borders on being identified as a face, but not identifiable as a specific person. Okay. And like the video said, for the third portrait, I was moved by an interview with Carolyn Felicity Antone, a Tohono O'odham Reservation rape survivor. Instead of taking her own life, she started a nonprofit to help other young Native women who've been abused or are in abusive relationship. And it's called Young Women Are Sacred. I contacted her and explained the portrait, and she agreed and was very supportive. And here's some more process shots with that one coming together. This one's almost done with reflected light. And this one is finished. This is finished with transmitted light. Okay. And then this is with reflected light. And remember with the other, I'll go back. So transmitted light going through the butterfly wings, light bouncing off the butterfly wings. Okay. This is Rebecca Plenty Wounds. She was murdered on the Wind River Reservation, October 2017. The case is still currently open, and the official report said it might have been suicide, even though when they found her body, it was completely dismembered. I contacted her sister, and she sent me her photograph. And from that photograph, I created this portrait. I was really inspired by Gerhard Richter's black and white paintings of the mysterious deaths of the RAF members of 1977. They were also deemed suicide, but there was widespread suspicion that they were murdered. And like Richter, I hope that by way of reporting, these portraits can help raise awareness to this heinous issue. Now, the Highway of Tears is a series of murders and disappearances of Indigenous women in British Columbia from 1970 until right now today, 2020. And Isla's body on the left there, she was found in February 2016. She's also the youngest. She's 14 right there on the highway. I tried to contact her mother here on the right, but she was killed in a car crash less than a mile away from where they found her daughter's body on the same highway. And I wasn't going to create her portrait because I like to get the family's blessing, but then I saw in the news article Audrey's necklace of the blue butterfly around her neck there. And I was like, okay, that's a that's a sign I need to make this portrait. And so here is a close-up of her eye, and you can actually see the butterfly scales of the wing itself. And then this is Isla with transmitted light. And then this is Isla with reflected light. I show you the blue morpho there. They go from a beautiful sienna to an iridescent blue. And while I was creating that portrait, this happened on the same highway, September 17th, 2018. Jessica Patrick's body was found. This is still an active and open case. It was also important for me to focus on the survivor. So this is Rosetta Peters. She's another activist and survivor. This is 6 inches by 8 inches. At this time, this was the largest one that I'd made. And then, so we're gonna put the technical hat back on. Like, so how do you actually make your light panel slowly fade on and off? I contacted my brother. I worked with him. He's an electrical engineer. I worked for about a year on this. Him and I would go back and forth. And we finally figured out how to, on the right here, make the microcontroller control the light panel and still be able to pull it out and code it in Arduino. Okay. So this is what the finished portraits look like when they're all done there. And then this is what they look like in the gallery next to the large scale portraits, the actual photographic images on the right there. And the original precious object is 5 inches by 7 inches and a 14 by 17 inch frame on the left there. Okay, what am I doing right now? Well, this is a bad image because I just got this off my Instagram, I apologize. But right now I'm working on Rita, and Rita was Osage in the 1920s. Her house was blown up. You should, if you're interested in this, read the book, Killers of the Flower Moon. At the time in the 1920s, the Osage people became the richest people in the country because what happened was people pushed them onto that part of Oklahoma, but they didn't realize they were sitting on the largest oil reserves in the country at the time. And so what happened was these people would come in, marry into these women's families, and then kill off the women. And this happened over 400 times, right? And so Martin Scorsese is working on a film of this right now, but this is Rita, one of the women that it happened to at night. So this was 24 inches by 36. This is the largest butterfly portrait that I'm currently working on, but I really enjoy how it's coming on. It's coming along, right? And so I'm all finished and we can open up to questions, but the last thing I wanted to say was, you know, I believe that these portraits are turning hard psychological truths into messages of change and beauty. And people always ask me what my inspiration to work prolifically is. How do I work on multiple series at the same time? Well, it's an intrinsic motivation that wakes me up every morning to create work that inspires thought, creates dialogue, and can express the present moment that I'm in. So in conclusion, always explore technology and art, be open to nature, and find the medium that will align with your message. Okay, thank you. Thanks, thank you guys very much. And I will unshare that, do there.
That was so interesting to me. That was incredible. There are several questions we've got lined up already. Some people have already texted me some questions. And some of those, I guess we'll start out with some of them. The first one that we got, what made you take a positive perspective on phones and mobile devices when most artists shun them?
Right, that's a really good question. You're right, even the Ricks Museum, it wasn't just artists, it was curators, museums, nonprofits, mm-hmm. organizations were like going against them. But I mean, I look at my niece and nephew and it's like, it's part of their technology, it's part of their world. We shun them because we were old and I wasn't born with an iPhone. So I've known a world without it. And so I can be like, that's future crazy there. I don't want to have anything to do with that. But kids children, they've always been born with it, okay? So they're never gonna be afraid of it, and they're always gonna be like, why would I ever not have that? Why would I not wanna FaceTime my grandma? You know, like, it doesn't make sense to them, okay? So all these rules were made by older people who are afraid of the technology. So you don't be afraid of the technology in your art. Use it. Go the other direction, right? Okay? It's important to do that because you're not going to get around it. You're not going to, like, they lost all those battles. People are now using their smartphones. People now are designing apps, the Ricks and the Nelson. These museums are now just like, you know, maybe we should use these tools for our advantage rather than fight that they're even here, right? That'd be like, so say you were born into a world without fire, and then when someone came along and was like, this is fire, check this out. And you're like, whoa. And you're like, no, seriously, I can cook my food with it. I can warm myself by it. It's amazing. It's technology, okay? It's like, if you weren't born with it, you're always gonna be afraid. You're not afraid, but you're gonna come at it with a little hesitation. But we were all born with TVs, right? So I can't imagine a world without a television, right? And so when artists first started using TVs in their work, the same thing happened. You know, it's like, well, you can't use TV in your artwork. That's crazy talk. So that, I hope that answered your question. Like, think about it from a larger view of, you know, what timestamp you were born into and the technology that was around you when you were born, okay? And so you're alive during a certain amount of time and you're only gonna have a certain amount of technology. So use it, use laser cutters, use your cell phone, figure out how you can grab the attention of the viewer, right? Okay?
Good, I agree with that. That was from Madigan. Thanks, good question, Madigan. Steve Black, you had a question. Are the colors, pigments in the butterfly wings archival or stable?
Excellent question. Yes. Under, like, if you set them out in the Phoenix sun for like 10 years, they would start to fade. But the color is a reflective property on each scale. So it's not exactly like a color of a leaf that's going to fade, or it's not chlorophyll that's going to fade. And I did a lot of research, and when I had my, when I did the fellowship at Yale, I talked to Carol Snow, who's the head of preservation for the art and entomology. And so we had a great conversation, and we spent a lot of time together just about that, like how archival and stable are they? So the London Museum of Entomology has some butterflies that are like over 300 years old that they've still kept up. So, and I use acrylic to bind them to the glass. And then on the backside, on the inside of that frame, I vacuum seal those originals in between archival mat board. So there's no air. And again, that's part of the reason I had that fellowship at Yale, was to talk about how to stabilize and really make these archival, you know, so they wouldn't just be like falling off of things. Also in the 1930s in South America, they had this like, this fad of like, they would make these like drink trays, and they would collage butterfly wings in them and then put them behind glass and then sell them to tourists. And some of those, you can still find them on the internet. They're still really stable, color still true, which is pretty interesting. So. Yeah, it can be. Now, if it's not sealed, it can be, it's organic protein, so it can be eaten by another worm or something. But if you seal it correctly, it can be pretty stable. And that's why I do the large scale photographs too. So, okay.
That makes sense. All right.
Yeah, good question.
Another from Taylor Mario. Out of all the projects you've done, which one has been your favorite and why?
Whew, that's a tough,
yeah,
man, that's a tough, that's, wow. Man, can I say light? And like, light is my, like, dealing with how light reacts now, like getting, thinking as an artist about a composition that is both reflected and transmitted, and how can I write a double narrative through that? It's kind of my new favorite thing to think about. But the butterfly portraits to me are the deepest. If I had to pick one, it would be the butterfly portraits. to answer your question.
Interesting. I don't have any more written questions. Does anyone else have any questions that are online? Just unmute yourself and state your question if you do. We'll open it up for a couple more if we need to. We're right at the time limit, but just to open it up if you want to ask something else. Anyone? I love the comment that I wanted to say actually is that you were talking about how you were projecting your identity into your images and how it was one of your newer images that you were talking about how we use our phones every day. And, you know, you're bringing this technology into your artwork. That's the way I feel about my artwork. I feel the same way about use my cell phone. I show shows in galleries, museums now with images. People are amazed. I said, I shot them all on my cell phone. They're like, what? Are those real photographs? You know, are those real photographs? But yeah, a photograph is a photograph, you know, and especially digital. It's ones and O's, you know, it's data, you know, and it's just, it's not a photograph till it's printed in my thing. And so it's got to be printed. And any way to get that final form, no matter if it's butterflies, pixels, or if it's the pixels from a phone, I think that's the important thing. Getting it out there, getting it seen, getting it out of your phone, getting out of that little machine technology and getting the light behind it or in it so that we can see it. So I really get what you're trying to say in this. So anyone else?
I can ask questions, author.
Yes, go for it. I'm
Hi, Benjamin. So let's see. Hi, it's from Tucson. So yeah. I'm just kind of curious about like from the work that you have shown us, there's a very strong, like the muse, it seems to be the women figure in a lot of your work. I mean, this body of work that I saw, oh, father and son, right? But it seemed like it's a little more of like technologies, a cube of light that one of the portraits that you're creating. But it seemed the representations of the women exhibit a lot in your work. And I'm just kind of curious, was there a reason why that seemed to be the muse that you go back as a subject matter? Like there's something like maybe you can talk about the relationship you have with women growing up, like with your mothers. I'm just curious. I know they definitely have some thread kind of scoping you the way you are in the interest that you have, but I just want to use this opportunity to hear that from you. That way we can educate other men how to treat women right? So I just want to ask if you can kind of talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, absolutely. So that a lot of questions and a lot of, yeah, so you're right. There is a lot of figurative work and there is a lot of women. So, I mean, my relationship with my mother was definitely the matriarch of the family. She was definitely the boss. And I love her so much, you know, like she's actually always been supportive of me. You know, my father wanted me to be an eye doctor. He wanted me to go into science and biology. I was a biochemistry major before I switched to art. My mom taught me how to watercolor. My mom taught me how to paint. She taught me how to oil paint. She's also a painter. I mean, she's an artist, right? So I learned early on right from her, and she always had a Degas in her bathroom. Even though we lived in a tiny little mining town in Lovelock, she had this Degas Appraise Le Bain, you know, of his bathing series, always there. And I used to always just stare at it, you know, and I didn't know why. And that was like one of the only art pieces we had in the house. So, you know, I'm actually trying to think of like why. That's a good, really good question you brought up. So that's early imagery of the figure that I really remember. And then I think that, I guess just the form, like sculpturally, is very relatable, like to people, like just from like a sculpture point of view. But I want to get more into the masculine though, like in the end series for the You Change Nature, I want to bring in female and male figures interacting for the next like ones on the slide. But I guess it does come from like painters and seeing the form. Modigliani, his work, Degas, using the female form as a muse, but not as like, you know, like degrading, right? Like not just to exploit sexuality. Like I completely I don't think that, I mean, not only that, it's like we live in a world that's completely oversaturated with that anyway, right? So like positive form, you know, not, I don't try to use the form in an erotic or degradatory way at all. And you can kind of see that it's more like mother nature. And Marilyn Minter, you know Marilyn Minter's work? How she does close-ups of, she does close-up, highly realistic paintings of women's faces, really done up with makeup, but then there's like acne on the forehead. And it's like, that's real, right? Like, it's just real. Like, and so like, I'm conscious of that. I mean, you don't want to sway too far, especially, you know, right? You want to sway too far, and you know, I tried to keep them neutral. And I also, you also noticed that I didn't want to put like a race or identity on a lot of the form. I intentionally keep the form with the sky behind it, because no matter what race we are, in that series, I wanted to talk about how little time we actually have on this planet, right? That's another thing we don't realize, is how long this planet has been here, how long the universe has been forming. And so, yeah, the gender and the female form is there, but I wanted it to just be as if it's like kind of really transparent and translucent on the planet itself. The grass, I just wanted to show in the form as being as figure itself. I don't know if that answers your question. I hope I'm getting close, but that's a really good question.
Yeah, that's pretty close, but I have so many more questions I would like to talk to you, so I find a different opportunity to do that. Yeah,
thank you. I mean, you can ask another one now if you want to. Yeah, it's up to you.
I don't think Arthur wanted to. Thumbs up.
Okay, he's doing though. Cut him off. Drag. I like the fake drag off the.
We've got about 5 minutes. If anybody, I mean, does anybody else have anything? I see somebody wants to know about your social media.
Yeah, the Instagram is, I think, at Ben Timpson or at Benjamin Timpson. I can't remember that, but.
I really, their new sculptural things with the cutaways, with the news media, those are really interesting to me. I really want to see more of those. Though, you know, because my work is all about social media as well, so I really want to see those. Those are really nice.
Or yeah, you know, the plan for that is like, because I did a whole print edition of people taking screenshots and then scan their heads, so I have the sculpture, and then also the print editions I want to wrap around the gallery.
Yeah. Okay.
So then you don't have to like actually piece the slices. Because the first sculpture I did, I watched people and they were like trying to slice. It was just awkward. Here's another tip for you guys. If you have a show, watch people interact or look at your work. It's really valuable to do that. And then so for the next ones that I'm working on, I want to try to get a grant to actually cut the head slices out of glass and then laser engrave the headline with glass. Yeah. On them and the print edition, and like have a whole group of these people just having this conversation about what they think is true, you know, in the gallery, and just have people like finally get that third person, like, wow, maybe we really are complaining about nothing when we should try to come together and solve major issues on the planet. And you know, but anyway, yeah, I can't wait to work on that one some more too.
All right. Well, good. Well, great. I appreciate that. We're looking forward to seeing that. Y'all, I thank y'all for joining us for this inaugural talk. I really appreciate everybody here who showed up. We really appreciate you, Ben. I'll give you a round of applause again. And stay tuned. Our next talk will be next week. I'll send emails out. If you'd like to join the website, join our mailing list. Just go to the Shircliff Gallery online, or just it's easier to Google Shircliff Gallery, Vincennes University, to find it. And join our mailing list, and you'll get updates about what Zoom talks are going on each week. And y'all have a great day. Thank you for joining us. Thanks, Ben.
See you guys.
Thanks, Steve.